Hey guys, it's Greg with Apple Explained, and today we're going to explore the history of Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference. This topic was the second place winner of last week's voting poll, and if you didn't get to vote, make sure you're subscribed. That way the voting polls will show up right in your activity feed, and you can let me know which video you'd like to see next. So Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference, or WWDC for short, is an annual event organized by Apple that gets a ton of attention from all over the world. It's one of the most anticipated technology events every year since it's when Apple makes some of their biggest software and hardware announcements. We'll look at an overview of the conference as a whole, and then get into some of the more detailed history of the event since it first started. And when did it start exactly? Well, the first WWDC was held back in 1987. The conference was and continues to be a massive showcase for Apple that gives journalists, developers, tech insiders, students, and the general public a chance to get a first look at new products and software to be released by the company. The five-day event begins on Monday morning with a keynote address, followed by different sessions like workshop presentations, lab consultations, social events, and meetups until Friday when everything comes to an end. Sessions cover topics like programming, hardware changes, app design, and more, and are presented by Apple engineers themselves. Most of these sessions are filmed and live streamed and made available for viewers on demand after the conference. In addition to these sessions, conference-goers can meet with Apple developers one-on-one to workshop app ideas and prototypes or get advice on a variety of app-related topics. It's not all technical talk at the WWDC, though. On top of the lab and information sessions, there are usually quite a few social events as well. Every year there's a beer bash, now just called the Bash, with live music for attendees. During the day, groups hold meetups to discuss issues like AI, tech accessibility, and women in sciences. Some non-Apple employees who are experts in tech and science fields give lunchtime lectures, and for several years, attendees got to participate in a Stump the Experts quiz game complete with prizes. The conference also has a number of associated unofficial apps to help attendees manage their schedule, find interesting events, and connect with other people. Finally, dozens of third-party events take place across the city for the duration of the conference that, while not put on by Apple, draw in attendees of the WWDC to capitalize on the visitor traffic during that time. So you probably know that the Worldwide Developers Conference takes place in California, but its exact location has changed over the years. The first year in 1987, it was held in Santa Clara, and from 1988 to 2002, it was held in San Jose. It moved again between 2003 and 2016 to San Francisco, and recently moved back to San Jose in 2017 and 2018. Along with the location, the dates have shifted slightly throughout the years, but it usually takes place in early to mid-June, with the most recent conference in 2018 being held from June 4th to June 8th. Now, this event probably sounds like a lot of fun, and if you're a big Apple fan, you'd probably really enjoy attending. But tickets to the WWDC are extremely hard to get and extremely expensive. Just one ticket costs $1,599. And if you're thinking, who in their right mind would pay that much to attend a conference? Well, I have news for you, because in 2012, all 5,000 tickets to the Worldwide Developers Conference sold out in just 2 minutes. And after this happened, Apple realized they needed a better system to handle the high demand, so they introduced a lottery system. And that means today, developers interested in attending the conference have to submit an entry registration form and hope that their name is drawn so that they have the opportunity to pay $1,599 for a ticket. But luckily, this isn't the only way to get a ticket to the WWDC. Apple offers free ticket scholarships to students in a STEM field who show promise in technology. In 2018, the scholarship application required submitters to create an interactive Swift Playground app that was judged for its creativity and technical accomplishment. And other conference goers are able to grab tickets that were never claimed in the lottery process, but they still have to pay full price. And for all of us lottery losers or people who can't afford to attend, we can still watch most of the conference content online. Now, it's worth mentioning that the WWDC isn't the only Apple conference that's ever existed. In 1985, IDG World Expo, a marketing group, hosted the very first Macworld Expo. This event combined an exposition and a conference into another week-long event that was held semi-annually, once in San Francisco and once in another location, usually the eastern United States, but sometimes going as far as Tokyo. The exposition part of Macworld featured not only Apple's own work, but devices and software from outside developers that supported the Mac platform. The conference portion included a keynote from Steve Jobs and later other members of the executive team. Some big announcements were made at Macworld over the years, like the introduction of the iPhone in 2007 and the MacBook Air in 2008. The most unique thing about Macworld, though, was its culture. The expo was known for having a pretty crazy social scene and a long list of parties that attendees could go to during the week-long event. But eventually, Apple decided to put its focus into its own Worldwide Developers Conference, and in 2008, the company announced that it would no longer participate in Macworld after 2009. Now, this wasn't the end of Macworld, since it continued to be held for 5 more years, but the 2015 event was canceled, and future events were put on an indefinite hiatus. Now, getting back to Apple's WWDC, we're going to talk about some of the most important announcements and releases that have been made at the conference over the years. In the first decade or so, from 1987 to about 2000, the conference had plenty of announcements, like the first public demo of QuickTime in 91, OpenDoc technology in 96, and Rhapsody in 97. The 2000 conference featured the usual updates on existing projects and a few major announcements, but in 2001, Apple stepped up its game and WWDC became less of a progress report and more of a highly anticipated event. Although macOS 10 had already been released by the 2001 WWDC, Apple announced the release of macOS 10 Server and WebObjects 5. This was one of the first conferences where a culture really started to develop, since the thousands of attendees received a leather jacket with the Roman numeral 10 embroidered on the back. The OS 10 hype carried through the next year too at the 2002 WWDC, where one of the sessions included a fake funeral for macOS 9. Next, in 2003, one of the biggest announcements was the launch of the Safari browser, which was finally out of beta development. Other big introductions included a demo of the Power Mac G5, previews of macOS 10 Panther, and some special attention to Steve Jobs' newfound relationship with Pixar, since the conference offered an advanced screening of Finding Nemo and received their very own first-gen EyeSight camera. By the next year, word had definitely spread about the benefits of attending Apple's WWDC, and ticket sales for the 2004 conference grew almost 20% compared to the previous year, with 3,500 developers in attendance. During this event, Jobs announced the release of macOS 10 Tiger, iTunes 4.9, which was the first version with podcast support, and new external displays. Jimmy Eat World also headlined a concert at the Apple campus for attendees. 2005 marked a big year for Apple and their WWDC. It was at this year's conference that Jobs announced they would be making the switch to Intel processors, marking the beginning of a long-lasting partnership that still exists to this day. Like the previous year, there was an increase in attendance and free entertainment from popular musicians like the Wallflowers. The following year included the release of the Mac Pro, a powerful new desktop computer, and yet another development in the Mac operating system. During this year, 4,200 people attended the conference as its reputation grew even more popular in the tech community. Now, in 2006, Apple had already made its biggest announcement of the year in January, the iPhone, but there is still plenty to discuss later that year at the WWDC. Steve Jobs revealed the official release date for the iPhone, a highly anticipated announcement for everyone watching, and the following WWDC in 2007 saw a beta release of macOS 10 Leopard and news about a Windows-compatible version of Safari. This was also the year that Jobs announced the company name would be changing from Apple Computer Inc. to just Apple Inc. This change reflected the recent shift in Apple innovation away from only desktop consumers to a broader range of products. And just like previous years, the conference grew in popularity with over 5,000 people showing up. But the next WWDC in 2008 marked the first time tickets for the event were sold out. At this conference, Apple revealed the iOS App Store and the first update to the iPhone line, the iPhone 3G. In 2009, Steve Jobs was unable to deliver the keynote because of medical issues, so instead, Phil Schiller, the vice president of marketing, took Jobs' place. Schiller previewed upgrades to the previously released unibody MacBook Pro, announced the iPhone 3GS, and showed off macOS 10 Snow Leopard. In 2010, Jobs was back, and he revealed the iPhone 4, FaceTime, and the name change from iPhone OS to iOS. The WWDC's popularity continued to rise, and tickets sold out for the 2010 event less than 2 weeks after they went on sale. Now, 2011 was Steve Jobs' last year hosting the WWDC, and he announced new software like iCloud, iOS 5, and macOS 10 Lion. At this conference, a scholarship ticket was accidentally awarded to a student under 18, which was the mandatory attendance age at that time, but the student personally petitioned Tim Cook to attend, and the mandatory age limit changed to 13 years old. In 2012, the ticket system for Apple's WWDC was becoming antiquated since they sold out almost as soon as they went on sale, and that was disappointing for many people who simply couldn't access the website quick enough. But despite this, the 2012 conference was one of the biggest yet, with the release of Apple Maps, the new MacBook Air and Pro models, macOS 10 Mountain Lion, and iOS 6. In 2013, Apple revealed new versions of the Mac Pro and MacBook Air, as well as iOS 7 and new AirPort models. And in 2014, Apple finally responded to the ticket issue by creating a lottery system to level the playing field for everyone who wanted to attend. At the event, presenters announced the development of Swift, a new programming language, OS X Yosemite, and iOS 8. And in 2015, it was announced that Swift would be open source and support not only iOS and OS X, but Linux as well. Next, in 2016, the WWDC keynote featured the introduction of iOS 10, the name change from macOS 10 to macOS, and a partnership with Cisco Systems. This was another big announcement year for third-party developers who are now able to expand functionality with several Apple applications like Siri, Maps, and Messages. In 2017, Apple used the conference to announce improvements to the MacBook and MacBook Pro, the release of the iMac Pro, and new versions of the iPad Pro, and the release of iOS 11 and macOS High Sierra. Finally, the 2018 conference was held in the first week of June, and while there were no major hardware updates, the event did have a number of other important releases like iOS 12 and macOS 10 Mojave. Once again, tickets were sold on a lottery basis, with opportunities for scholarships for students who participated in the Swift Playground Challenge. With no big hardware releases this year, some developers are expecting to see Apple introduce upgrades to the MacBook line and possibly new, smaller versions of iPads in 2019, but it's hard to predict what the future might hold for new Apple products, services, and partnerships. Overall, the Worldwide Developers Conference has been a week to look forward to in the tech world for over 20 years. Although expensive and often exclusive, it's an event that many feel privileged to attend, whether it's for the new products or software, opportunity for learning, or unique social experiences. And for those of us who can't attend, keynote and session videos are always made available online. So that is the history of Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference, and if you want to vote for the next video topic, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.